go through the entire speech because I might have to have more time for questions and discussion. So I'm just going to make a few points. I was told to come here to be a troublemaker, to get the middle class and ratepayers more active in the struggle for poor people. And it's unfortunate that there aren't many middle class people here, and not all the residents of Seapoint have come. So we're going to have to figure out a strategy to deal with that as we go forward if we really want to have one city and a unified city. So there's a few points that I want to make, but first I have to just give you a few facts. We are told by researchers and academics that there's 3.5 million people living in Cape Town. The city is divided into 111 wards or areas, each one having their own ward councillor. There's about 250 informal settlements. 250 informal settlements in the city of Cape Town. And between 270,000 to 400,000 households, we don't know the exact figure because the data hasn't been collected properly, live in informal settlements, okay, or as backyard dwellers in formal sites. So that translates into about 1 million people of the 3.5 million people who live in the city of Cape Town, who live in inadequate homes or live in depressed physical environments. In other words, informal shelters and backyard dwellers. We have one mayor and one city council. So the second question I want to talk about is, now that we have the facts about where we're really living and what's going on, is what do we mean by a chasm? The topic for tonight is how do we overcome this chasm, how do we overcome this divided city of Cape Town. The first thing you have to remember is that internationally, we are regarded as an upper middle income country. Now that may be surprising to many of you, because South Africa is still regarded, even though it's an upper middle income country, as one of the most unequal societies in the world. Income by race group also remains substantially disparate, with the majority of low income households in South Africa still remaining black after 1994. A large proportion of out-of-school youth and adults are not working in our country. About two-thirds of all unemployed people are below the age of 35. Comrades, I'm going to say that again. Two-thirds of all unemployed people in our country are under the age of 35. Almost all of the job losses, according to our government, that happened in 2009 and 2010 because of the global recession, were experienced by those under the age of 30 and with less than a grade 12 education. So we have a youth unemployment time bomb. While racial inequalities persist, it is class inequalities that are growing in a new South Africa, with income growing in the hands of only a few people, and some of those few people include some big black businessmen. So the chasm or the gap or the divide or whatever you want to call it is of course economic and it's growing, yes. But in this city, like other cities around the world, like other cities in South Africa, it is also deeply racial. And it's exacerbated by apartheid geographic planning as recognized internationally by the OECD and our own government. So a mayor or a premier who refuses to recognize that is really living in a fool's paradigm. The third question I want to talk about is, who are we? Who are these 3.5 million people living in the city of Cape Town? Where have we all come from? And why are we made sometimes to feel like as if we don't belong, and to make those divisions even stronger? Now, a very interesting study which was commissioned by the city of Cape Town, the 2007 community survey, showed that at that time, and I don't want to use racial terms, but this is the only way in which we can talk about South Africa and its racial politics. But half of all white people in Cape Town were born here. The other half were not. About a quarter were born in Gauteng and moved to Cape Town, and the other quarter were born overseas and moved to Cape Town to live here because of business or retirement opportunities, or they fell in love with a South African and married them. By the way, my husband's a foreigner. Okay? It also showed that the majority of Indians and coloured who live in Cape Town were born here. So over 90% of the Indians and coloured who live in Cape Town were born here, and they've always been here. And it showed that while just under half of all black people were born here, at least half were actually born in the Eastern Cape, and they migrated to the Western Cape. So the chasm that is often forgotten when we talk about a divided city is about the place of birth chasm, it's about that provincial chasm, the one that is Gauteng Eastern Cape versus the Western Cape. And then, of course, there is the local foreigner chasm, with many, many people moving here from other parts of Africa as refugees, as asylum seekers, as migrants, and then people who come from Europe and North America, and in some cases South America, as business people or people who want to retire. desire becomes very interesting and essential. But the final chasm, the one that worries us all, that keeps us awake at night, as we try and live in this so-called beautiful city, well-designed capital, top tourist destination in the world, is that of worsening and unequal living educations and unequal educational opportunities and outcomes, irrespective of place of birth, yet largely correlated with race and income or class. So 17 years into our democracy, the school that's publicly funded to my right in Lindano, down the road, about 15 minutes, has 100% numeracy and literacy rate. And the school in Kailicha to my left, about 30, 40 minutes, if you're using your own car and longer if you take public transport, probably has numeracy and literacy rates of less than 20%. So that's what we talk about, the chasm between the city, between people who live on the one side of the mountain and people who live on the other side. And the question tonight we have to ask is, will we see this divide get worse? Will it improve over time in Cape Town? And just because other cities have similar divides, just because other countries face the same problems, does it make it acceptable for us here in Cape Town to take so long to remedy this? So first, I think we have to start by accepting and acknowledging the triangle of privilege. And I grew up in an Indian ghetto, but I'm privileged because I got a somewhat better Indian Bantu education, and I was given an opportunity to study a law degree, and by virtue of my profession, I've been able to jump a class and become middle class. So we must recognize privilege. Even black people, Indians, colored, and whites have to recognize that. First, apartheid was an evil system that premised promotion, wealth, land ownership, business and professional opportunities and access to education on race. We weren't special, we weren't clever, we just happened to be the right color and therefore we were given specific opportunities. But that racial superiority and that system of apartheid translated over time into economic privilege. Privileges that our black comrades in Kailicha were not able to receive or benefit from. And that economic privilege, the one that I benefited from, being able to get a tertiary degree, then resulted in political power or influence, and today it's no different. Because when I send an email to the mayor or somebody in the city of Cape Town, they respond within sometimes a few months or sometimes a few days. But when other people who don't have a law degree send an email to the mayor or somebody in the city of Cape Town, it can take years for them to get a proper response, if they get a response at all. So given our relative privilege, and there's a few of us here, not all of us, but some of us here are privileged because of our race, and you have to accept that. Because of our class, and you have to accept that. Because of our educational paths and opportunities that we were given that other people were not, and you have to accept that. What can and should we do? So the first thing is that ratepayers, Ward 54, okay, we'll come to that just now. We, as ratepayers, as property ratepayers, as payers of personal income tax, because we earn such high salaries, we wield enormous, enormous influence and power in this and in other cities. And so we have a special duty and an onus to respond to this triangle of privilege, because it's simply unacceptable for us to continue living such divided lives and such economically divided lives for the next 17 years. So ratepayers associations have to be vigilant. They have to hold the city accountable, they have to hold the mayor accountable, but they also need to promote not just their own neighborhood interests, but also the interests of neighborhoods that have been shown to you tonight. Take Ward 54, which includes the Atlantic Seaport Stroke. Now, I've counted at least five ratepayers associations for this ward, and there's only about 8 areas in it. Okay? Independent. They're supposed to work in partnership. They manage to secure the maintenance of key services for their areas in which their members either live or where their members do business. And they have almost immediate access to city councillor and or the mayor's office at any given time. And I tested it this week. I wrote to a random ratepayers association and I said, I think there's a problem with some parking spaces in the city of Cape Town. And within 24 hours I got a response, and within 24 hours the local city councillor who's in charge of transport and parking spaces in the city of Cape Town wrote to me and said they're going to investigate and look into it, and thank you very much. So it shows the amount of influence and power you actually have as a ratepayer or being a member of a ratepayer association. And given the economic influence of ratepayers associations and of other people who pay rates, because rates are the second highest The second highest contributor to the city's operating revenue, or its budget, or its cash cow, whatever you want to put it. It can therefore play a significant role, one that seeks not only to protect its own interests, but the interests of all 3.5 million people who live in Cape Town, irrespective of where they were born. So I want to tell you a quick story, and I hope the chair doesn't mind just giving me a few minutes of indulgence, about why ratepayers are so important to the mayor and the premier and the city, or why they're regarded as so important, and why they are the key to unlocking the abhorrent inequality in our city. Because they can be used, number one, as a convenient tool by any city and any mayor, as they've been in the past, to justify certain omissions in policy or responses to people who are most in need in all parts of the city. And for this reason, ratepayers have to resist being used as a justification for shameful acts, for policies of government inaction at municipal level, and instead use their financial muscle to force change and improve the living conditions of all of us. You'll recall, many of you were involved, not in the attack, but in helping us to respond to it, of the 2008 xenophobic pogrom that happened in our country. We asked the mayor, who's now the premier, to open up a community hall, this one, near in Seapoint, to 20,000 displaced refugees who had nowhere to go because their homes had been destroyed and they'd been attacked by local people who felt that they should leave the country immediately. We were told by the then mayor, by the city council, by the premier as well, and that, at that time it was an ANC premier, that the ratepayers were not supportive, that they had birthday parties and wedding events planned at this hall, and therefore they couldn't open it to the refugees in the middle of a humanitarian crisis, in the middle of winter. We were told that ratepayers closer to the city would not permit refugee camps on vacant land next to their businesses and their homes. But these are the same people who were condemning the xenophobic attacks. Okay? And the city then established 5 controversial and intolerable tented refugee camps on the outskirts of the city with the support of the then premier and near the ocean in the middle of winter. And the rest, obviously, you know. To the residents of Seapoint's credit, only 300, but still to their credit, they lodged an objection with the city of Cape Town and the mayor. And despite writing an open letter and a petition which was put into the newspapers, the mayor refused to open up this hall and every other community hall in the city of Cape Town, largely because of the pressure we believe that was exerted on her by other ratepayers associations in Cape Town. So unless ratepayers significantly engage with the city and other people who live here about issues that are more than just about their own neighborhood, more than just about the Seapoint promenade, then the potential for a significant political push address this chasm or this divide or inequality in a real way in the next few years will be lost. This is why today I'm calling on all ratepayers to start a process where it publicly makes its objections and proposals on all issues available for greater transparency and less secrecy. No secret side meetings with the mayor where you lodge your objections to refugee camps or other interventions for those most in need. Let's be transparent. Let's be less secret about all your demands and all your prejudices and your ideology and your vision for a unified city. Let's be open about what we want and let's work towards some key areas of consensus. Now, there's one final thing that I want to address, and that's the myth about the economic role of ratepayers. Because we always tell, but the ratepayers won't support this, and but the ratepayers won't support that, and we can't do this because of the ratepayers. But let me tell you something. We've studied the budget, and yes, property ratepayers, people who own land, own property, and own businesses, contribute significantly to the city's operating revenue or their profit. But over time, the city itself is forecasting. The city itself is saying that they estimate that the total percentage of property rates that will contribute to the city's operating revenue will drop from 23% in 2009-2010 to 19% in 2013-2014. So they expect that the revenue they're going to get from property ratepayers is going to drop. Does that mean the influence will drop too? We're not sure. Property rates are the second highest source of operating revenue for the city and amounts to approximately, wait for this, 3.8 billion rand in the 09-10 financial year, or 23% of the total revenue that the city gets from all of its different sources of revenue. So it's quite significant. 23% of its money is coming from ratepayers. But if you look at the City of Cape Town budget, which we've been doing with the Social Justice Coalition and the Independent Budget Program, and Shamila is sitting right here, you'll see that the single largest contributor of operating revenue to the city is not the ratepayers. People, it is not the ratepayers. It's actually service charges. Which means that each one of us here, each one of us who lives in the City of Cape Town, every one of us that is linked to the electricity grid and gets water and buys services and buys groceries and uses public services and a minibus taxi and a bus is actually contributing to the revenue of the city. So all of us are actually contributing, and we're contributing even more than the ratepayers. The amount that the city receives from service charges in 2019 is 8.7 billion rand, or 52% of its operating expenditure. 8.7 billion rand from us in service charges. It aims, the City of Cape Town aims over the next few years to even increase this amount, which means we'll all be contributing even more. 10.6 billion in the 2010-11 financial year, 12.4 billion in 2011-12, 14.7 billion in 2012-13, and by 2013-14 they forecast that they will get 17.5 billion rand in service charges, which is 61% of its operating revenue. Comparing this to property rates, bringing in by that time only 19% of operating revenue, which amounts to about 5.6 billion. So what this means is that all of us are contributors to the system, and therefore we all have an equal right to demand accountability and reasons for all the money that the city is spending and for the reasons why they're not spending it in areas that actually need it the most. So in summary, what I want to say is that for too long, all politicians, irrespective of which party they come from, have deluded themselves into thinking that only ratepayers are the most important in the city because they pay for services. Well, we have news for them, and it's based on their own budget. We actually all pay for services, and we actually pay a hell of a lot more. And those of us who can't afford to pay for bulk services, and some of us who just vote, okay, and we've got to address that. We pay in other ways. When we buy food that's not zero-rated for VAT, when we use public transport, when we buy cleaning materials, toiletries, etc. Because VAT, value-added tax, that you pay on most of the things that you buy, including on books, is part of the money that is raised by the national government. And some of it gets distributed to the City of Cape Town for the delivery of basic municipal public services. So we are all equal citizens of the city, even if somebody is born in Zimbabwe, even if somebody is born in Jordan, even if somebody is born in the Eastern Cape, even if somebody is born in France. And we must therefore demand an equal say in the policies of the city and its budget allocation and spending program in all areas. And therefore, I'm inviting all the ratepayers today, whoever's here, and you please invite your friends, to come with us in the Social Justice Coalition when we do our sanitation walk. Because until you see, smell, and feel the shit on your shoes and your clothes in our sections in Taiwan and other informal areas in Cape Town, you will not be able to appreciate why the need for partnerships with residents in other wards of Cape Town is urgent and critical. Why this is just one step towards building a partnership of humanity and common values. So finally, I think that the message that needs to go out to ratepayers associations today is that you will have to appreciate that an inward-looking approach to living or doing business in this city is not going to be feasible financially, constitutionally, or in any other way. And regrettably, we won't have activist ratepayers overnight, but we can only hope. And we can try to begin to cross that divide. We can lessen the chasm by ensuring that over time, this city becomes home to all of us, not just those who can afford to pay rates or are privileged in other ways. Thank you.